week, if you notice, our reading begins with the setting of Jericho. The apostles, people gathered around Jesus, he's just sharing a parable. This is, in a sense, his last sermon, his last teaching, and he's done it at Jericho. Symbolically, very significant place for the ancient Israelites and the Hebrew community. Jericho being the place where those little fledgling family tribes of Israel came together and made a stand against a great foe. This wonderful story of the Battle of Jericho is a kind of nationalized hero story that gives importance to how these tribes come together. And when families and communities come together, they can do great things against great odds. And especially for the Hebrew nation, this is a chrysalis, foundational moment for them as a people. The beginning of nationhood, and it happens in this moment against great odds. This is intended to pick up the same theme of against great odds and great foes. When we come together, we can do much, and we can do new things we never expected. So from that begins a journey in this last teaching. If you've ever been to that region, what happens geographically is Jericho's sort of down here in this fertile valley of the West Bank. And you literally, when it says he goes up to Jerusalem, he does. He goes up the crest of that valley, walks along sort of a perpendicular valley, and this is where the West Bank is, a smaller valley, narrow and very steep. And it's not like Disney World. These things don't have, fences, so you're not going to fall off and kill yourself. You will, you can. And on one sheer side, carved into one side of the valley, is the pathway that would have been used in Jesus' time and still used by pilgrims making this journey today. On the other side of the valley, carved into the wall, is this ancient Roman aqueduct that would have been Herod's aqueduct, literally draining off the life waters of Jerusalem and its hillside into his summer palace at the other end of this valley. So here they are, looking at the symbol of their oppression as they are making this journey into the foothills outside of Jerusalem. And on these foothills are the communities of Bethphage and Bethany, where Jesus had very close friends and community there. He makes frequent trips before the time that we know as Holy Week or Passover. He does frequent trips down from Bethany into Jerusalem. And each time he's back up at Bethany, he's staying with who? Lazarus and Mary and Martha, who live in Bethany. So before he gets there, he gives this instruction. Okay, go in and find this colt. When they say, what are you doing? You say, it's for the Lord. The Lord needs it. That's a little bit of a code. This has been arranged. This is all preset here. Plans have been made for this day, for this final entry into Jerusalem after all these things. This one matters. This one has symbolic meaning with intention. The symbol of this young donkey is no mistake or accident. Why not choose a horse? Why not walk? Because in the Hebrew symbol system, David, Solomon, the kings of the Israelites, are kings who want to represent peace, not conquer. When they come into new villages that they have conquered in battle, they don't come on war horses with equipment of war. In history, they come on donkeys, symbolizing their intent is not to make war, but to bring peace and wholeness in the way that they rule. So quite intentionally, he's riding this donkey. And when they make the statement that they come down, down to the Kidron Valley, and then once more back up into Jerusalem. And the Kidron Valley is a giant Hebrew graveyard. You can look down from Mount Olives and see for miles grave sites, gravestones, entombments that are millennia old. And the reason was that the Hebrews themselves, in their vision of the Messiah, was that this Messiah would come on the last day for resurrection of the faithful. And they were going to come not just anywhere on the planet, but to Jerusalem. They would be resurrected there. So where do you want to be on the last day, on that triumphal moment? You want to be as close as possible so you get raised first. Don't you? To this very day, faithful Jewish practitioners often request that someone who is journeying to Jerusalem bring back even just a little bit of dirt from that valley so that it can be put with them in their casket. Somehow, the idea that just being a little bit of contact with that assures this immediate resurrection and promise of eternal life. So here they come then, from Mount Olives, where they see this glistening mountains and domes of Jerusalem into this literal valley of death. How apparent it would have been, making a journey, seeing this huge symbol of their oppressor, of the Roman Empire's exploitation of the Hebrew nation, then coming down to this valley of death, knowing that their actions in challenging that power could lead to their own death, and they would in only moments be buried there. And through that, they entered Jerusalem with great joy. With great joy. Are they nuts? One of the other symbols that we get in this story that we hear about and can kind of look over as a sentimental symbol is the palms. We don't grow these here in the Northwest. Why are we using these? It's to connect us to what this represents. The palm tree was the symbol of the house of David. By specifically grabbing palm branches, at least in the narration of the story, the symbol is meant to share with us the claim that's being made by the community of early Christians, which is that in the face of a history of oppression and exploitation by the Roman Empire, it's not just that that's a problem. In the day and time in which Jesus is born and has lived his entire life under the Roman Empire, but also when they conquer Jerusalem and the Hebrew nation, they slaughter the rightful heirs to the house of David and the rightful heirs of the royal priesthood. And they replace those civil and religious leaders with people willing to be collaborative with the Roman Empire in the oppression and exploitation of the people. So there was corruption, simple and plain, going on that they were also challenging among their own people. This is making a statement that the rightful loss needs to be restored. There is a commitment and a voice in these hosannas that call for the restoration of the people and a just leadership that will bring all that that leadership is supposed to bring, of bringing food to the hungry, of bringing justice to those who are oppressed, of bringing freedom to those who are imperiled. This, along with the cries of Hosanna, which sometimes get translated as just happy day, is more accurately, culturally translated to mean emotionally, freedom, freedom, freedom. How much more powerful is that? humble journey of peace, bringing inclusive and specific symbols of peace and freedom. On the opposite side of Jerusalem, on the same day, is entering Herod with his personal bodyguard of 3,000 Roman troops. Because the time of Passover, faithful Hebrew people are making pilgrimage to Jerusalem to celebrate Passover. The city will swell 3 times its size with the Hebrew nation. A Roman emperor who's not really that cool with having that many potential resurgents gathering in one place sends symbols of their power and their might and their kingship, a power based in fear, a power based in oppression, a power that relies on the people being willing to be subjugated to that power, to be subjugated by violence. In the face of that group coming in, we have an alternative model of leadership. One that is gathered around it, people who love one another, people who love him, that even in the midst of whatever disagreements they may have, are gathered around an ideal, a precious vision that the world can be different and that they have the power to make it different. That is the power that no one can take away. They may take your life, they cannot take your spirit. The spirit that God has given, the spirit that calls in your heart for freedom, true, deep, and genuine freedom, to love, to bring shalom. And the only way to do that is to follow a way of peace for all people in Christ.